Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can all hear me and see the screen okay. If one of you could please quickly go into the Q&A and just say, yes, I see everything fine, that will be very helpful. Otherwise, I'm gonna get started with the presentation. Oh, excellent, thank you so much, Ms. Torres. I am going to get straight into the presentation. Thank you very much for joining me. My name is Henry Abramson, and I'm really excited about being part of Kosher Riverboat Cruises, where a couple times a year, I get to go to various places along rivers in Europe and explore Jewish history. And we usually take about 100 people with us on these fantastic boats. And we basically just get to experience Jewish history in real life, like while we actually visit the streets where it happened, which is absolutely fantastic. So today, in preparation for a cruise that is scheduled for, when is it scheduled? It's scheduled for August this year. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the saga of Dutch Jewry. And then we'll have a little bit of opportunity at the end to have for some Q&A, both about Dutch Jewry and about the cruise if you are interested. Okay, so why don't I get started right away with the material? I figure I'll speak about the history for about half an hour or so, and then we'll go to the Q&A. Okay, so here we are. The origins of the community. First of all, let's locate it. Where exactly is Holland and Belgium, the Netherlands area? As you can see in this Google map here, it's on the northwestern coast of the European continent, not too far from England. And here's a picture of Holland in particular, the Netherlands in particular, excuse me, which is made up of actually several provinces. North and South Holland are two of the most significant. And I think a more important way to think of this area, though, is not so much this political map here that shows the various administrative provinces, but really this map here, which of course shows you the tentative route that we're planning to take in our cruise in August, alongside this map here, which shows you how much of this region is actually under sea level. The blue parts, the sky blue parts, are below sea level. And of course, you can see Amsterdam is like right in the middle of a lagoon there. It's, it's protected by some kind of barrier island. But if it were actually to be inundated with the waters of the Atlantic, it would be flooded. So how is it possible that you have a city there? This is, and quite a bit of this region, really right up to the region of Utrecht, you can see it's completely below sea level. How is it possible that this region is settled? So this is the origins of a very clever and well-known Dutch saying, God schiep die aarde, maar die Hollander schiep in Holland, which translates as, and forgive my pronunciation, God created the world, but the Dutch created Holland. And this is absolutely true in a very, very real way. What this is referring to is the massive amount of water engineering that went on in Holland in particular, the creation of these things called polders, which are essentially by managing the water and building up the peat and draining the peat, they were able to actually create serviceable land where the region could be actually farmed and you could actually build on. This really begins in the 14th century and it continued with great success afterwards. Here, I'll show you a couple of pictures. Here is one of the many, many water engineering stations that dots the countryside in this region. You can see the Archimedes screws there that pull the water up from the right-hand side of the picture and dump it out on the left-hand side of the picture. And this creates this massive region of very, very flat areas for farming and for settlement. This is where you get the term the Low Countries, because of course it is below sea level, and yet nevertheless it is in fact reclaimed land. Now, there's some fascinating research on how this geography affected Dutch culture, politics, and society. And I was very, very interested in reading this. I recently read Russell Shorto's remarkable work on Amsterdam, in which he speaks about the impact that this region, or this, the nature of the land being underwater, had on the Dutch people as a whole. Specifically, we're talking about a part of the world where the nobility didn't own any of the land because the land was underwater. It was actually ocean. And so here you have a whole bunch of peasants who say, hey, listen, what if we were to go out into the ocean and have this audacious idea of making farmland out of the ocean? Then that would be ours, right? That wouldn't belong to the nobility. We could just farm it ourselves. And the only way that this could be done is if we all cooperate with each other, because these are massive public works. No one person can drain this region. It has to be done in concert with many other people, and it has to be done both with a great deal of individualism, because you've got to do your part for your particular piece of farmland, but on the other hand, recognizing that you are part of a much larger whole and everyone has to hang together, or else literally we will drown in the ocean. So out of this sort of system of thinking of landless peasants deciding to cooperate and build a society together, you have the unusual fashioning of the Dutch mindset, the Dutch culture, that really can be seen in so many different aspects of their culture. One of the most interesting words that I came across was this word gedogen, or gedogen, I think it's pronounced, which means illegal, but officially tolerated. Because if you live in this kind of society where everyone has to get along, if you have a neighbor who does something that is not, you know, something you approve of socially, religiously, you know, politically, as long as he manages to keep up his part of the social pact and keep the polder drained and do what he needs to for the water management, you know, you're prepared to just live and let live. Just let him do what he's going to do, as long as he is observing the norms of society, insofar as our economic reality is derived entirely from our cooperative nature, then that will be okay. And so the Dutch culture really evolved around this basic concept. We see it certainly in 20th century politics with issues related to a lot of the topics that are very controversial in North America, especially in the United States of America. They seem to be much more run-of-the-mill issues in the Netherlands. And what's especially important for us, although I hope you appreciated this very brief geology, land management kind of discussion as an opener, it has a huge impact on Jews, because Jews will be great citizens of this region as long as they fit into the overall social needs of a society that needs to hang together. And in fact, that's exactly what the Dutch offered the Jews. They were able to live in great peace and tranquility in this part of Europe for many hundreds of years, and created a very unique Jewish society. So that's what we're going to look at now, is a little bit of how that society evolved. Let's start, first of all, with where the Jews came from. Like, how did they get to the Netherlands in the first place? So we have to step back a little further, quite a bit further, actually, and try to see how did the Jews get to Europe in the first place. So the very, very earliest Jews to reach the Netherlands were the so-called Ashkenazi Jews. Ashkenazim are basically Jews who trace their ancestry back to the region of Ashkenaz in basically northern Germany, the Rhineland. This is, the term itself is somewhat artificial. When the Jews settled there, they sort of picked it out of the Bible and said, okay, let's call this Ashkenaz. There's no real connection biblically between the name as it's used in the book of Genesis, and just one particular offhand reference. Later, there's a reference to the book of Jeremiah as well. We don't know where those locations are as described in the Bible, but they're highly unlikely to be located in northern Germany. That term was associated with the Ashkenazi Jews much, much later. Here's basically how they get there. And this chart, by the way, is derived somewhat from the literary record, where, you know, we have a 12th century account of how Jews got to Ashkenaz, written several hundred years after they had already well settled there. And that bears all of the challenges of, legendary history that can be written as a way to try and explain a current reality rather than necessarily describing a historical process. But it's also been augmented, fascinatingly, with current DNA research, which says a lot in a scientific manner that actually bolsters this traditional account. Here's how basically Jews got to Ashkenaz, which would be just a little bit west of the Netherlands. And then we'll start talking about how they moved from there to the Netherlands. We start with Jews in ancient Israel, right up until the first two colossally devastating Roman-Jewish wars. The Jews of Judea rebelled in the first century, starting in the year 66. That was crushed by the Romans. It took them quite a while. It was a pitched series of battles, but eventually it was crushed in the year 70, with pockets of resistance lasting for a few more years. This was the great Roman-Jewish war that resulted in the destruction of the temple. There was then a smaller regional war called the Kitos Rebellion in 117, and then a much bigger rebellion that in many ways rivaled the first war in the year 132. All of these, of course, were crushed with some remarkable challenges by the Roman government. The Jews of the region were frequently punished, particularly in the First War and in the Bar Kokhba Rebellion, with forced deportation to the Italian peninsula, where they worked as slaves. According to Josephus, there were as many as 100,000 of these Jews who were taken from Judea in the first century, a number that many scholars believe is fairly accurate. And these are how the Jews basically got into Europe, primarily through Italy. Let's see how it works. So if you look at this chart, you see you've got the arrow on the left, which means time, moving from earlier in time at the bottom, later in time at the top. You have Jews in ancient Israel. And then in the first and second centuries, about 100,000 of them are basically sent as slaves to Rome. By the way, there was already a Jewish community in Rome prior to the first Roman-Jewish War. In fact, a good 200 years prior. But the massive influx happens in the first and second centuries. And then while they're living there, they're also integrating with larger society. They ultimately eventually get citizenship. There's actually a fairly large number of Jewish citizens in the Roman Empire. And you begin to see the penetration of Italians into the Jewish ethnicity. This is largely done, as far as we can tell, through conversion, because when we get to about the year 800, there is what's called the founder event. This is referring to the foundation of Ashkenazi society. Sometime around the year 800, based on both literary sources and later bolstered by DNA evidence, a very small group of Jews, primarily from the northern region of Italy, make their way up to the Rhineland. The cities of Köln and Mainz, Speyer, Worms, and they settle there. Some DNA evidence even indicates that about half of all modern day Ashkenazi Jews are descended from four specific women who come from northern Italy. That is, their mitochondrial DNA, the little bits of DNA that a person gets from one's mother, and only women pass it down, means that they had four specific mothers. I like to joke that their names were, you know, Sarah, Rachel, Rebecca, and Leah, but probably not. At any rate, these people were, you know, conversion is allowed within Judaism, and so these women were incorporated in that small group. We know the names of some of these families. The Colonimus family, for example, made their way to the north at this time, and it's confirmed by two major discoveries that where the DNA evidence reveals that they were in fact descended from these people. In the English city of Norwich, in about the year 1290, about a dozen people were thrown down a well, and when the and this was discovered in the 21st century when they were doing construction for a shopping mall, and they found this ancient closed up well, and inside it was this horrific discovery of all these bodies jumbled up, all thrown in there at the same time. And they were able to analyze the DNA in the bones and discovered that, in fact, they were very similar to modern day Ashkenazi Jews, and that their DNA is going to match what was discovered in the city of Erfurt, Germany, a Jewish cemetery where, since we suspected in advance that the people buried there were Jewish because of historical data, the people working with the skeletons asked for appropriate rabbinic guidance that said that you could work with the DNA in teeth that had been separated from the bones. And by analyzing the DNA of those teeth, the reason is because Judaism has a very, very high threshold of permissibility to, disinter corpses or to rebury them and things like that. So they studied the separated teeth of these 33 odd bodies, and they found that it, just like the trove that was found in Norwich, these people were also closely related to them and very closely related to modern Ashkenazi Jews, meaning there is a kind of a genetic bottleneck where, as opposed to like having all kinds of people mixing together in the region, here's this small group of people associated with modern day Ashkenazi Jews who basically only marry each other, which obviously has some genetic challenges. There are certain diseases that are associated with Ashkenazi Jews, including, for example, the Barca gene that is a plague for breast cancer, and cystic fibrosis and Tay-Sachs and all kinds of things like that. The Ashkenazi Jews, before they get married, they typically use modern technology to screen themselves to make sure that they are an acceptable marriage partner for the person that may be their intended. At any rate, we basically have like a really narrow bandwidth of potential marriage partners for the next 700 years until we get to modern Ashkenazi Jews who are genetically very related to that founder generation, that founder event, probably from the year 800. One last detail before we look at a map that will help clarify this. There's a strange supposition that's been around since the 1970s that perhaps Ashkenazi Jews who eventually would move more to the east, they would be, for various reasons, expelled from Western Europe by anti-Semitic pressures, and they would be invited into Eastern Europe. That would be Lithuania, Poland, Ukraine in particular. They would be invited into Eastern Europe for economic reasons. Their proximity to a bizarre Turkic tribe known as the Khazars, who around which there is a legend that they converted to Judaism in the 8th century, that in fact this argument goes that modern Ashkenazi Jews are descended from those Khazarians rather from the Middle Eastern Jews who mixed with the Italians. The DNA research does not support this particular thesis. What does it actually look like? Here is a map from one of those remarkable DNA studies. The purple lines are the most important for our purposes. You've got, after the first century, a massive movement of Jews, largely as a result of those Roman Jewish wars, into the Italian peninsula. They then continue on in the 9th century up into Northern Europe. There are also Jews that are simultaneously making their way across the coast of North Africa. That's the Green Line. And they develop a very major center in Spain. And then those Jews from Spain will later mix with the Ashkenazi Jews. Ultimately, where you see the number three, those large Ashkenazi populations will move very far east, where they will become much more dominant in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and its successor states. But that's basically the charting out the major DNA trackable population movements of Jews, which largely corresponds to what we know from the literary record. The Italian presence is extremely important. If you look at the DNA of the Ashkenazi Jews in Erfurt, that was the 1350 discovery, the Ashkenazi Jews there have about 15 to 45% of their DNA going back to the Middle Eastern populations, that is to the ancient Israelite Jewish population, and about 45 to 70%, very large number, a large amount of their DNA is actually from the Italian populations with whom they lived for several centuries before making their way up into Europe. So that's basically how Jews got to Europe. How did they get to the Netherlands? So we have only a few isolated references of Jews in the Netherlands until about the 13th century. Then we begin to see them pick up a little bit. The largest settlement of Jews are clearly in the Rhineland, which is in northern Germany, just a little bit to the west from the Netherlands. Don't forget that the draining of the swamps, the bogs that made up later would make up Holland was not really, you know, deeply underway until about the 13th century. So there's like not a lot for Jews to visit there anyways. But nevertheless, you begin to see isolated references of mainly traveling Jews who end up in this region in the 12th and early 13th century. They're described frequently as merchants or as moneylenders, but they're really, really scattered references to them. This continues increasingly over the 14th century, but really big things happen in the 15th century. Let's turn to that now. This map is also really important. This is, of course, a map that describes the emigration of Spanish and then later Portuguese Jews in the wake of the Great Expulsion of 1492 and the forced conversion in Portugal of 1497 and the associated exodus of Jews from that region as well. Let's just pause for a second and think about what is going on here with this. To understand the Spanish expulsion and its massive impact on European Jewish history, we really have to go back about 100 years before the expulsion to 1391. There was at that point a series of pogroms, kind of like riots directed at Jewish populations throughout the Iberian Peninsula. And one of the unusual consequences of those particular riots was a massive number of forced conversions. In other words, you had like, you know, masses of angry peasants descending on Jewish communities and demanding that they convert or die or be horribly maltreated. And you have a very large number, perhaps tens of thousands of Jews who elect to undergo the ritual of baptism, often done right then and there with holy water on the spot. And, you know, Jews were kind of like, you know, deeply confused about what this actually means. The church, which had long condemned this practice of forced conversion, nevertheless was kind of trapped within this ideological position that once a person is baptized, even if it was done under duress, they are nevertheless Christian. And so you had this unusual situation that happened in Spain, and it lasted for about a century, where you had these people who considered themselves Jewish and yet were legally Christian and were free from all of the anti-Semitic legislation and restrictions that had required them to live in certain regions, only occupy certain occupations, never be allowed to attend higher education. All of a sudden, it's as if they received Christian driver's licenses. And so you have this phenomenon, and there is a spectrum. There are some Jews who became true believers and completely committed themselves to Christianity. You had others who were deeply resentful of the imposition of Christianity on them and would go to tremendous lengths to practice Judaism in secret if necessary. And then you had people in between, people who were, you know, willing to go along to get along, but still consider themselves very Jewish and married other crypto Jews, or as they were called, conversos or new Christians. So Jews actually, and I'm talking about now these crypto Jews, they actually succeeded under this social environment because they were no longer held back by these artificial restraints that society had placed on them as Jews. And they rose up in virtually every area of human endeavor, with the possible exception of subsistence farming, because they were literate, they were numerate, They were urbanized. They had a very high level that they placed on education. And so over the next 100 years, from those pogroms of 1391 until the eventual expulsion, you had this phenomenon where there was like a second class in Spanish society of people who traced their origins back to Jewish roots and may have been extremely active in their Jewish practice, but nevertheless had, you know, very high level positions in Spanish society, even in the church. So when you get closer to the end of the 15th century, the church decides, actually the crown in Spain decides that they've got to do something about this, and they institute the Spanish Inquisition, which was not technically speaking directed at Jews who were not baptized. It was directed at those Jews and their descendants who had been baptized and yet were not behaving with all of the requirements of Christians, or more significantly, they were not believed to be behaving in this manner. And so they had this whole purge-like mentality set up where, you know, they would arrest these suspected people of Judaizing to one degree or another. They would torture them. Of course, the Spanish Inquisition was infamous for its use of torture. And under torture, these people would give up the names of all kinds of people that they thought were also Judaizing. This was, you know, it's information derived under duress is not very reliable, but the Spanish Inquisition would then go out and arrest those people and eventually subsumed all of society. It got way out of control. So by 1492, Torquemada, the Grand Inquisitor, who also traced his own family roots back to these conversos, so a lot of weird psychological stuff going on there, argued that, you know why this is not working? You know why we keep trying and trying and there's still these Jews active in Spain? The reason is because there are still non-baptized, legally practicing Jews in our society. They're still maintaining schools and they're still maintaining kosher meat shops and they're still maintaining, you know, rabbinical services. And so the crypto Jews are always being drawn back to these sources of communal intellectual spiritual refreshment. So Torquemada argued persuasively before Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand that all the Jews have to be kicked out of Spain, not the baptized Jews, because they're technically Christians, but all of the regular non-baptized Jews must be exited from the peninsula. And that is in fact what happened in 1492. They have this massive exodus. As you can see from the red lines, they're headed to North Africa. They're headed throughout the Mediterranean basin. Constantinople was a very important refuge for them. And many of them go back to Israel, where they would later be the kernel of the great Sfat Renaissance in the 15th century and the 16th century. The most significant number, of course, made the simple journey to the west and crossed the border into Portugal. What happened there is especially significant because King Manuel I decided that it was not expedient to expel these Jews who had a lot of value economically to the society, but he arranged for a forced mass conversion of all of them in 1497. Again, the same kind of thing that started this all off back in 1391. And he made all kinds of promises like, you know, we're just going to do this, but there's going to be no Inquisition for a good 30 years. Don't worry about things. You'll be all right. Thinking that eventually they would assimilate into Portuguese society. He was, of course, wrong. And when the Inquisition came in Portugal in the 16th century, it was even more brutal, if that can be imagined, than that happened in Spain. And so many Portuguese Jews in the 16th century began to seek ways to flee Portugal. Many of them went to Brazil, which was, of course, a Portuguese holding. Some of them even ended up in New Amsterdam, which, of course, would be Manhattan or New York City. And a lot of them went to the Netherlands. So you have this massive flux of these interesting people who called themselves a separate nation, the Portuguese Nacio, the Portuguese nation, who were basically Jews, still thinking of themselves as Jews, still building synagogues, praying together, marrying within their own families, and yet they all trace their origins back to Portugal specifically, and they had status as Christians. They could travel to other countries. They could even travel to England, where the Jews had been evicted in the 13th century. And they became extremely important in the mercantile world with their connections in many of these other countries, Jewish connections, and they were extremely important for the advance of the economy. And so if you think back to what's going on in the Netherlands, they have this idea of gedogen, right? The illegal, but unofficially tolerated. So even though, you know, depending on who was controlling the Netherlands at that point, and there was a lot of Spanish influence and so on, they basically said, well, listen, these Portuguese people, we know that they're probably doing something kind of fishy, kind of Jewish in their homes and things like that, but they're not bothering anyone else. They're not specifically involved with draining agricultural land, but they are contributing to society through their mercantile activity. They're keeping their head down, not bothering anyone. So why should we be persecuting them? This was also in line with a form of Protestantism that was very strong in this region, in contrast to Lutheranism that was much more prevalent in parts of Germany. Calvinism was a more of a tolerant version of Protestantism that held to kind of Luther's original position that, you know, Jesus was born a Jew and so on, and that there's no reason to persecute the Jews. So these Portuguese Jews were the first to make a really strong communal foothold in the Netherlands, establishing communities there, officially only in 1608, but most likely they had been there for decades prior. They just began to be more open about their Jewish identity in the early 17th century, and they succeeded. They were tolerated, they were given permission to establish synagogues, they printed their own prayer books, things like that. And later on, they would be joined by an influx of Ashkenazim, who were coming from Eastern Europe, particularly in the wake of the Khmelnytsky uprising of 1648-49. Ironically, you know, we live in an era that tends to be Ashkenocentric, meaning, you know, just the way the population movements in the Jewish world work, Western Europe and North America is predominantly Ashkenazic. That tends to be a wealthier part of the world. And so, you know, we have this stereotype of Ashkenazim kind of being the big brothers helping out the Sephardim and the Portuguese Jews, who are the younger brothers. In reality, at this time, it was definitely the opposite. The Ashkenazim were the needy immigrant Jews, and the Portuguese were the well-established, wealthy Jews who demonstrated tremendous generosity and largesse in caring for these massive influx of Ashkenazi Jews. But that's one of the things that I think makes the Netherlands so fascinating in Jewish history, is it's one of these meeting places of multiple Jewish populations with very different attitudes and very different perspectives on life and the world, and it creates some of the most fascinating ideologies. And that's what we see especially happening. Perhaps the most famous Jewish inhabitants of this region are Spinoza, and as a distant second, really, maybe not even second, but famous for me at any rate, Uriel da Costa. This is a remarkable painting that, if you've heard any of my lectures on Acosta before, please forgive me, because I return to this figure quite often. He is someone that I think is extremely important for our understanding of Jewish modernity. Uriel da Costa was a Portuguese Jew who, like many, did not learn of his Jewish identity until he was a teenager. It was very dangerous, of course, for Portuguese Jewish parents to tell their kids that they were in fact Jewish, because that could like bring the whole Inquisition down on them. So his parents ultimately, you know, divulged his identity to him. He had already earned a degree from the University of Coimbra in theology. And he was very, very excited about it. He said, oh, this is fantastic. And they moved to Amsterdam. He actually spent some time elsewhere in Europe as well. But he was unable to fit in with a Dutch society, Dutch Jewish society, because largely he had this, you know, this ideal of what Jews should be like that was based entirely on reading only the Christian version of the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament. He read about Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Moses, and David, and he thought, wow, Jews are so fantastic. But when he got to Amsterdam, he saw they were regular people, that they were sometimes, you know, not so careful with their language, and sometimes not, they didn't demonstrate at the highest level of integrity that he thought. He became quite a bit of a gadfly on the community, and he took it to extremes. He actually published books criticizing the Jews from within, but a really nasty kind of criticism. Ultimately, he was excommunicated by the Dutch Jewish community more than once. And after a third, and he kept on coming back saying, please, I have to live among you. I can't be separated. Ultimately, after a third and ritually humiliating rapprochement, he decided that he should rather take his own life, and he died by suicide after leaving a 12-page suicide note, very moving document called Exemplar Humanae Vitae, an example of a human life, that says a lot, in my humble opinion, about what Jewish identity means in the modern era. Now, sitting on his lap in this remarkable picture, you can see that Da Costa has this, he's all dressed in black, and he has this, you know, kind of like, you know, claw-like grip on the edge of the chair, and he's got this thousand-yard stare. He looks very somber and even a little morbid. And sitting on his lap is this, you know, carefree boy with long golden curls, and he's languidly holding onto some flowers while looking askance at the text of a book that's supposed to represent Spinoza. And in fact, they do overlap about this many years in Amsterdam. Spinoza went through much of the same process as Acosta did, but unlike Acosta, he was able to somehow simply say, well, okay, that's fine. I'm not too worried about it. I'm going to go on my merry way. And here, the same artist in 1907, a few years later, painted this version of Spinoza excommunicated. He was a Jewish lens grinder who became very interested in other perspectives on the Bible. And he, in fact, essentially invented what would be called later biblical criticism. There's a lot more to say about Spinoza and more than we can spend here, but in many ways, he is the architect of modern philosophy. He was also excoriated by the community, who felt that his ideas were not only antithetical to Judaism, but they were also antithetical to the protection of the community, because the Amsterdam Jewish community did not want to rely on this idea of illegally but officially tolerated. They wanted everyone to stay in line and, like, you know, have their ties on and look proper. And they regarded him with some hatred and fear. Whereas in this painting, you see his attitude of, well, you know, I'm sorry about that, but I'm going to go on my merry way. Much more to say about Spinoza, but nevertheless, he is indicative of the intellectual ferment of the Jewish community there, for good or ill, depending on how you understand his thought. It was a place of tremendous activity, a tremendous exchange of ideas, huge center of printing. You may recognize this frontispiece from the Amsterdam Haggadah, which is a landmark in printing, a copper engravings that were illustrated that Haggadah and used on, you know, hundreds of thousands of Jewish tables every Passover. It was illustrated by Abraham Bar Yaakov, a fascinating convert to Judaism who lived in Amsterdam. This picture, which it depicts the artist himself as being none other than Prophet Jonah, you know, being tossed over into the waves and swallowed up by that great sea creature, and then he is finally deposited on solid ground. Avram Bar Yaakov, who signed his name at the bottom there, clearly saw himself as someone who, you know, was lost in the sea of intellectual ferment and found his home ultimately in Judaism, and he became a very important master copper engraver. And his work has, you know, been seen at the tables of who knows how many untold families, even here in America, because one of the most famous Haggadahs that's widely used, primarily because it was available for free from your local grocery store, the Passover Haggadah published by the Maxwell House Coffee Company is essentially the Amsterdam Haggadah. It went through a couple of iterations, but for the longest time, it was the Amsterdam Haggadah itself. So when we get to the 20th century in this very quick overview, Jews are finding themselves very much at home in Dutch society. And one of the most heroic moments came at the lowest point in that history, and that's specifically during the Holocaust. Now, one of the things that is really unprecedented in Europe during the period of the Nazi occupation is a widespread general strike that began in Amsterdam, specifically in protest of the treatment of Jews in that city by the Nazis. As you can see, here's the actual document that was circulated. You can even see strikes, which means strike. And you get a sense of the anger that average workers in Amsterdam felt over the abuse of their traditional tolerance that had been extended to Jews. This strike was, as you might imagine, horribly and brutally truncated by the Nazis, who used collective punishment, which was their go-to tool for controlling dissent, and it was crushed within a matter of days. But nevertheless, it is the only one of its example in all of Nazi-occupied Europe. This is a wonderful statue that was erected to memorialize that general strike. It shows a dock worker. And as you can see from this remarkable piece, I'm sorry, I've forgotten the name of the artist who constructed it. I have a separate video where we talk about it. The artist has chosen not to portray some kind of like neo-Soviet hero with bulging pectorals and a lantern jaw and things like that, which would have been really, you know, a travesty in this kind of example, because the Nazis also liked that kind of heroic, artificial Superman type art. This is like, he looks like, you know, he's in his late 30s, early 40s. He's overweight. He's just a regular working Joe, but he's looking up to the sky and his hands are like slowly clenching as he begins to feel the anger as how Jews are being treated, his fellow citizens in Amsterdam. And as his anger builds, he becomes resolved to engage in this general strike. It's a very, very touching and worthwhile statue. I can't wait to see it when we're there. Unfortunately, the larger story of the Jews in the Holocaust is not one of great heroism. In Amsterdam in particular, of course, that's where Anne Frank was deported and lost her life after recording her thoughts in her remarkable diary later published. And in fact, Amsterdam had a horrific demographic impact under the Holocaust, worse than most other countries. And that's the sad reality of it. But after the Holocaust, with the influx in particular of refugees from Eastern Europe, the Jewish population was eventually reconstituted in these regions and began to succeed and thrive once again. So God willing, I'm looking forward to seeing this in person in a few months. For those of you who are on the call, if you are able to join us, it will be great to have you. I'm going to conclude my presentation now, and then I'm going to turn to the Q&A to see if there's anything I can answer that will be helpful. Thank you very much for your attention and your endurance. Okay, so let's see what I've got in the Q&A. Stacey M., thanks me for letting you attend. You're most welcome. Mr. Lynch asks about Spinoza's parents and uses the term Marano. This term Marano is kind of fallen out of favor in the scholarly world because it literally means pig, and it was a term of opprobrium that was used to describe those people who were technically Christian but still practicing Judaism. The preferred terms are crypto-Jew or converso or even new Christian, which was the church term. So Spinoza, like Acosta, descended from these Portuguese crypto-Jews. Ms. Torres asks, Queen Isabel and King Ferdinand were inclined to acquiesce to Torquemada because they wanted to confiscate property and money from the wealthy Jews who were forced, and because the Jews were forced to leave them behind. And that way they could fund their war primarily against Muslims to the south. That is quite true. And in fact, one of the big debates in Jewish historiography about this period is, was the expulsion of Jews primarily an economic, was it a function of the economics of the region, or was it a function of ideology, meaning Ferdinand and Isabella were true believers, and they really wanted to get rid of all non-Christians from the Iberian Peninsula, make it not only totally Judenrein, but also Muslimrein, right? They wanted to also drive out the Islamic influence. And it's a massive debate. My humble opinion, I think the truth is somewhere between those two extremes, but the crown definitely stood to benefit from the seized property of the expelled Jews. They got into a lot of trouble later because there were still debts owed, and that had to be dealt with. And Christians were, you know, well entwined into the many of these economic arrangements. And so it was not just a simple matter to simply steal money and kick them out. It was something that you know, required quite a bit of disengagement over the next century. Ms. Stacy M. reads that in one of the Jewish encyclopedias that the Spanish Jews were embarrassed by the poor immigrant Jews and actually pitched in to send them off to the British Empire. This is unfortunately a phenomenon that we will see from time to time in Jewish history. Italian Jews were also, they had a varying degree of enthusiasm for accepting some of these Spanish immigrants. In other cases, in New York, for example, the earlier immigrants who came first from Spain and Portugal, and then later from Germany, didn't have quite as good an opinion about the Jews who were coming from Ukraine and Poland and Lithuania. So it is a phenomenon that repeats itself, unfortunately, many times in Jewish history. In Amsterdam specifically, the Portuguese did have a very strong consciousness of the need to support themselves and their own charities first, but the bulk of their charitable donations actually went to Ashkenazim, which is really quite fascinating, I think. Mr. Bosboom writes, how is it possible the Dutch went from tolerance and striking against Nazi treatment of the Jews to the most devastating stories of the Holocaust? That is indeed a very important question. I think the key variable that has to be isolated is the degree of collaboration of local populations in the destruction of the Jewish population. And that's something that is not at all simple to answer, particularly in a short Q&A like that. You know, we should recall that the Nazis had a very different attitudes towards how they occupied states in the West, which they regarded as their racial equals, and how they treated states in the East, like, you know, Poland, for example, Ukraine, which they regarded as their racial underlings. And the degree to which the local population was willing to cooperate with the Nazis was highly correlated with the treatment they received from the Nazis, which is a very, very different kind of thing. So your question requires far more attention that we can devote here, but thank you. Will the recording be made available on YouTube channel? Yeah, I intend to put it on there. And Mr. Barron asked my opinion on Columbus being Jewish or of Converso. Please have a look at my channel. There's a huge lecture there where I discuss it in great detail. Okay, that's it. Not too bad for timing. Thank you all very much for joining me. I think it would be great if we could learn together in person on this cruise. If that's not possible for you, then very happy to communicate my research as I go through it over the next few months on my YouTube channel. Thank you very much for attending this webinar, and I hope you all have a fantastic day.